since. It's been a long time coming, but I
welcome everybody. Let's get started here today. Another edition of Parlor Talks. Always keep an eye out on my emails. Folks who are, find their way to get into the Zoom. See, some folks found that link.
Beyond the sky, it's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. I go to the movie and I go downtown. Somebody keep telling me don't hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother and I say, brother, help me, please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my knees. Lord, there have been times that I thought I
this is a hard song to call scripture.
But now I think I'm able
to do a thing to play.
Carry on. It's been a long time coming, but I know change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will.
Thank you. All right. I'd like to welcome everybody who is joining us tonight, or maybe even watching the replay of our program tonight. Oh, Miss Bernadine, made it. Oh, how you doing? All right, cool. We got some good friends in the house tonight. It's gonna be great. Tonight is another edition of our Parlor Talk series. I'm Chris Rogers, public programs director for the Paul Robeson House Museum. I've been volunteering with the museum since about 2015. The Paul Robeson House and Museum is located on the corner of 50th and Walnut Streets in West Philadelphia. The Paul Robeson House and Museum is a project of the West Philadelphia Cultural Alliance. West Philadelphia Cultural Alliance is the 501c3, which operates the Robeson House and Museum. The West Philadelphia Cultural Alliance was birthed in 1984 through the work of Mama Frances L. Austin. And the Paul Robeson House and Museum was started in 1994. You can find much about what we do at our website, paulrobesonhouse.org. We're so thankful for everyone who could be here today. And I think what's even more crucial to our discussion tonight is the critical role that I think we represent in terms of the work of recovering and recuperating Black legacies and the many, everyday ways, and whether you're connected with the institution or not, that we do that around just folks in the neighborhood, but, reaching back across centuries to talk about the stories of how we have left a footprint on our world. So tonight's event is entitled Steenth Street, Recovering Alice Dunbar-Nelson's Stories of Black Childhood. And we were so grateful to receive this invitation. I think it began at a conversation I returned back to my alma mater, Villanova University, and we had an event that was sort of more centered on Black Lives Matter at school. But as we did that, we were able to make connections and say, hey, there's this also this other amazing project that's taking place and has a relationship with the School District of Philadelphia and my good friend Ishmael Jimenez. And what are ways that we can begin to sort of give a new visibility to it? And I was so grateful to be able to do that. And I'm excited to have our guests on the call. And without further ado, I just want to go ahead and, you know, read their introductions. As I say your name, please feel free to wave to the crowd. And thank you for everyone who's joining us this evening. Just be mindful of using your mute if you're not talking in that moment, just to make sure that our communication lines are clear. And I'm going to take a second, take a breath. Let's all take a breath, right? Let's all take a collective breath before tonight. There's a lot going on in the world right now. And let's inhale and exhale. So we'll have four speakers tonight, and I'll begin with Denise Berger. Denise Berger is the senior team leader for curriculum and community engagement with the Colored Conventions Project and co-director of Douglas Day, which just happened not too long ago, at the Center for Black Digital Research at Penn State. She is finishing her PhD in English at the University of Delaware on Afro-Protestant 19th century women writers. Her work has been supported by a dissertation fellowship at the Library Company of Philadelphia and has appeared in Legacy in the Collective Wisdom Handbook. Thank you, Denise, for joining us this evening.
Bridget Fielder
is an associate professor at the University of Wisconsin. She is the author of Relative Races, Genealogies of Interracial Kinship in 19th Century America through Duke University Press, and that's recent. So make sure you're looking on that, Duke University Press in 2020. And co-editor of Against a Sharp White Background, Infrastructures of African American Print, which came out through University of Wisconsin Press in 2019. Thank you for joining us this evening, Bridget. Cachet Garland is a senior criminology and English double major at Villanova University. She wrote her first editorial in her freshman year titled Land of the Dream, Home of the Nightmare. And her second in her sophomore year titled Mask Up, Don't Shoot. She now serves as lead research fellow for the Alice Dunbar-Nelson Steenth Street Project. And lastly, Jean Lutz. Jean Lutz is a professor and Lucko Family Endowed Chair at Villanova University, where she teaches American literature and gender and women's studies. Her most recent scholarly article was about Alice Dunbar-Nelson. All of the four speakers here tonight are IDLE Family Fellows. Their collaboration is partly funded by the IDLE Family Fellows Program of the McNulty Institute at Villanova, which supports innovative scholarly collaborations that advance gender equity and promote social change. So I want to give space, you know, that was sort of like the formal introduction, but also want to hold space if you have any opening words before we get into our first speaker of the night. So I want to just pass that open to our guests. To see if I missed anything, is there any acknowledgments you would like to make as we get started? Oh, good. Okay. Then we'll just go ahead and get started. I have slides for tonight. And Denise Berger will go first. If you want to turn your camera off at any point for some of our guests, you know, feel free. And just as long as you come back on when you're needed, I can make sure that you are spotlighted. So just give me a second to get these slides up and going. And leave from start.
Excellent. Thank you so much for that warm welcome. So on behalf of the Steenth Street Project, welcome. We are so glad you took the time to join us this evening. So we're being hosted by the Venerable Robeson House. Special thanks to Chris Rogers and the West Philadelphia Cultural Alliance, specifically without whom this event would not have been possible. So ladies and gentlemen, tonight you will learn more about Alice Dunbar-Nelson, poet, activist, educator, essayist, and the inspiration for the Black Digital Humanities Steenth Street Project. Cache Garland will begin with a bio and an introduction to Alice Dunbar-Nelson. Bridget will follow with an introduction to Dunbar-Nelson's Steenth Street stories. Jean Lutz will take us into the recovery of the Steenth Street stories with a focus on the story His Heart's Desire. And I will talk about the evolution of the Steenth Street Project as a Black digital humanities project. And Cache will close us out by making our call to action. After our presentations, we have set aside time at the end for questions and answers. So please do think about what we are sharing and what you'd like to know more about, and then save it for the question and answer section at the end. Or you can post it in the chat and we'll do our best to respond in real time. So right now, what you're looking at is a slide that honors and represents the Black Women's Organizing Archive. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about that and explain why each of us have an image from the BWOA as our screensaver. So the Black Women's Organizing Archive, AKA the BWOA, brings together the scattered archives of 19th and early 20th century Black women intellectuals, organizers, and activists. The BWOA moves Black women unapologetically to the forefront and the center of Black digital history projects to highlight Black women's often lost, erased, and or forgotten contributions to our intellectual histories and social movements. Comprised of students, faculty, and librarians based at the Center for Black Digital Research, Dig Black, at Penn State University, BWOA works in collaborative partnerships with community arts organizations, academic institutions, and repositories throughout the US, Canada, and abroad to locate, digitize, transcribe, and share the collections and papers of Black women organizers, activists, and intellectuals. Please come check us out at bwoaproject.org to find out more about the extraordinary women who led some of the most important movements in the early struggles for Black civil and political rights. On our website, you will find links to digital collections with primary materials about the featured women of the BWOA, as well as related research, scholarship opportunities, teaching materials, upcoming events, and opportunities for community engagement. The project is constantly building and growing, so check back often for new materials, exhibits, and resources. Now, clearly, we are not the BWOA. However, it is one of our principles to identify Black digital humanities projects and to lift them up whenever we have an opportunity to speak in a public forum. So tonight, we are highlighting and celebrating and lifting up the BWOA. All right, Cache.
Hi, everyone. Good evening. So Alice Ruth Dunbar-Nelson was born in New Orleans, Louisiana in 1875 to a formerly enslaved seamstress and a seaman. From the 1890s until her death in 1935, she had a prolific career as a writer, activist, and educator, but she does not receive the recognition she deserves because people simply do not know much about her. I never heard about Alice Dunbar-Nelson until I was introduced to the project during the summer. And when I read her stories, I love how she portrayed Black children in the Steenth Street stories, and I felt connected to it to my own childhood as a Black woman. However, the part of Alice Dunbar-Nelson that shocked me was the fact that she was a queer woman, but that part of identity is either left out or downplayed. Her marriage to Paul Laurence Dunbar is the most famous one, and there are books written about it. It's discussed in her biography. You learn about it in every part of her marriage. But with her relationship with women, biographies will skip over it or make it seem like the relations were not significant, and some could argue that they were not. But for me, seeing her as a queer Black woman, rather than just a Black woman, is important and why I'm interested in Dunbar-Nelson. But that's just one part of her life that a lot of people don't know about. And for that reason, this is why we are doing the project that we are doing. So now I'm going to turn it over to Bridget.
Thank you so much, Cachet. And so as Cachet said, Alice Dunbar-Nelson is not an unknown writer, but like many early African-American women writers, she's still underappreciated. So here's a picture of her circa the turn of the 19th to the 21st century. This is a photo engraving of young Alice Ruth Moore Dunbar, which first appeared in 20th century Negro literature, edited by D.W. Culp, published in 1902 by J.L. Nichols and Company. Mentions of her are too often overshadowed by her first husband, the noted author Paul Laurence Dunbar. But while he died young, Dunbar-Nelson's writing career extended decades later. She published from into the 1890s until her death in 1935. From the late 19th century and into the early 20th, she wrote poetry, drama, fiction, and essays. And she was involved in activism for causes such as women's suffrage, against lynching, and toward various other endeavors toward racial equality. A promoter and facilitator of African-American literature, her work included editing the AME Review, a publication of the African Methodist Episcopal Church, and anthologies of Black speeches, prose, and poetry. She also worked as a journalist, writing columns for the Pittsburgh Courier and the Washington Eagle. In this next image is a review of one book edited by Dunbar-Nelson, Masterpieces of Negro Eloquence, the best speeches delivered by the Negro from the days of slavery to the present time, which was in the New York Age in March of 1914. Like many notable Black woman writers, Dunbar-Nelson was also an educator. She worked as a public school teacher in New Orleans and Delaware and taught at the Hampton Institute in Virginia and at the State College for Colored Students, which would later become Delaware State University. We make particular note of Dunbar-Nelson as an educator because our project features some of her writing about children, her Steenth Street stories, stories that remain under discussed and which are still not entirely available to 21st century readers. According to her papers, which are located in the special collections of the University of Delaware Library, in the 1890s, Dunbar-Nelson had begun writing and planned a short story collection called The Annals of Steenth Street. This next image shows the most complete version of the table of contents available in the Alice Dunbar-Nelson papers and reveals something of her careful and curious arrangement of these stories. The collection revolves around a poor working class neighborhood that faces a myriad of socioeconomic problems, from poverty to domestic violence to reformers who could be either helpful or harmful. They sometimes provided a much needed meal to a family, and at other times they offered unwanted and unneeded attempts at intervention. These stories focus on some of the community's youngest members who also attended the local school that was run by educators from outside their community. From 1897 to 1898, Dunbar-Nelson taught Black kindergartners at a settlement house in a poor neighborhood in New York City's Upper East Side. The White Rose Mission in this next image, also known as the White Rose Home for Colored Working Girls or the White Rose Industrial Association, was founded by Victoria Earle Matthews to provide transitional housing and basic education to young Black women and children. This is the building that would house the White Rose Mission from 1918 to 1984. Steenth Street's fictional Pure Heart Mission is directly inspired by Dunbar-Nelson's time working with the White Rose Mission. While children are at the center of these stories, she includes not only parents, but also teachers among her characters, And many of the stories showcase children's relations, reactions to what their teachers say and do. It may be unsurprising that Dunbar-Nelson attended to children in her writing, but this point is worth noting. Literary and cultural studies scholars, educators, children's authors have noted the ways that childhood has been constructed in the United States, a construction that has historically imagined children as white. We understand this problem in modern day correctives to acknowledge and attend to children of color because a white majority has not prioritized them. But Black children have not been ignored. Black writers, and Black women writers in particular, paid much attention to Black children in their work. Although the absence of clear racial markers in some of the Steenth Street stories has caused some scholars to read her characters as white, we approach these stories about Black as stories about Black children and communities. This reading is in part a refusal to see whiteness as the default, to regard literary characters as white unless they're otherwise marked. Alice Dunbar-Nelson was a Black writer and educator of Black children who almost certainly did not simply construct childhood as white. Given the influence of these stories and Dunbar-Nelson's complex representations of race in her other fiction, we have more reason to read the Steenth Street children as Black. Moreover, some versions of some of these stories do include more overt references to race, suggesting that she may have revised these with multiple differently raced audiences in mind. Dunbar-Nelson appears within a tradition of attending to Black children, and this is no coincidence on her part. She's familiar with Black children in her teaching and racial justice work. She intertwined this interest with her promotion of Black literature. In this next slide, we see an issue of The Southern Workman. In 1922, she penned an essay, Negro Literature for Negro Pupils, which is listed among the table of contents of this February issue. This monthly periodical was published by the Hampton Institute. And in this piece, Dunbar-Nelson argued that instead of idealizing white literature, we should, quote, give children the poems and stories and folklore and songs of their own people. Being both aware of and a contributor to a rich and wide African-American literary history, she doesn't describe a dearth of Black literature for children, but instead acknowledges its existence, making a curricular argument for its inclusion in those children's education. We present the Steenth Street stories as an example of Negro literature for Negro pupils. Reading Dunbar-Nelson's collection is not only about, but potentially for Black children. But as we discuss these stories as part of an urge to give this literature to students of various ages, we want to first consider questions about access and availability. Now we'll turn to recovering Steenth Street. Dunbar-Nelson left behind one of the most extensive archives of any Black woman of her era, thanks in part to the loving, meticulous work of her niece, who we can see in the next slide, Pauline Young, a pioneering librarian who preserved her aunt's papers. These archival riches are held by the University of Delaware Special Collections. But for archives to grow in meaning and value, they have to be not only created and maintained and used, but supported, resourced, and promoted. The existence of Black women writers' archival records alone does not easily translate into their becoming household names among other US literary figures. In a world in which both whiteness and maleness have been and continue to be overrepresented, Black women writers are still undervalued and obscured in our literary history. Dunbar-Nelson in her Steenth Street stories presents one example of the need to attend more to Black women writers in the ongoing collective project of recovering their work for our contemporary moment. None of the 12 Steenth Street stories are easily accessible to readers today. Five of them were included in the three-volume Works of Alice Dunbar-Nelson, edited by Akasha Hall in 1988, pictured in this next slide. This remains the most complete collection of Dunbar-Nelson's work to date. The three volumes were published by Oxford University Press as part of the extensive Schoenberg Library of 19th Century Black Women Writers, edited by Henry Louis Gates Jr. But these volumes are costly. Each is now listed from $115 to $150 on the Oxford University Press website. And used copies have only limited availability. Only some of Dunbar-Nelson's short fiction is available in other accessible forms, such as via the African-American Woman Writers of the 19th Century Digital Schoenberg Collection, which you can see here in the next slide, Digital Schoenberg. While this digital collection includes some of her published work, the Steenth Street stories are not among those that are here. To our knowledge, the entire collection has not been gathered anywhere. We began our work on the Steenth Street Project because we want to make these stories more widely available and to put them into closer conversation with one another in the ways that Dunbar-Nelson herself seems to have intended. Our work is part of a larger project to recover early African-American women's literature, to make that writing available for our own contemporary audience. Efforts to recover both women writers and African-American writers have been ongoing projects for scholars of 19th and early 20th century literary history. Although far too many scholars have done groundbreaking recovery work for us to name them here, this work that's left to be done is still massive. It's also pressing and exciting, though not without challenges. Even writings that get recovered are often obscured again. Writers who are made visible sometimes are re-abandoned. Anthologies may not incorporate them while prioritizing white male canonical writers. And editors may not recognize a viable market for the republication of academic or trade editions of their work. Academics and other educators may not do the work of incorporating unfamiliar texts into our classes. Hull's 3-volume collection was an incredible undertaking, and these have been important for generations of researchers, but much of Dunbar-Nelson's work has still not been known and available to a wider readership. The difficulties of recovery work aren't simply evidence of individual failings, though, but systemic challenges. Lacking the support of white publishers, many 19th century African-American writers self-published their work, and much of early African-American literature was circulated in Black periodicals, which often struggled financially, not having the same scale of economic support as those which were backed by white wealth. Even as they themselves created literature, Black authors, like Alice Dunbar-Nelson, have had to build and maintain the infrastructures to make this literature available to the public. Black literary recovery projects are extensions of the work that Black writers have collectively done all along. Additionally, the recovery of Black women writers can't be divorced from histories of devaluing their work under the influence of both racism and sexism. It's common to see this work deemed unimportant, these writers dismissed because they're not already known. Erasing early Black women writers becomes easier when periodizations for popular notions of Black literature far too often begin with the Harlem Renaissance that emerges in the 1920s. Black women writers are also subjected to appropriation rather than responsible engagement. One recent project attempted to reclaim some of Alice Dunbar-Nelson's fiction, which was fraught with factual errors resulting from sloppy research and a seeming failure to engage responsibly with library archivists and expert content scholars. Recovering African-American women writers requires expertise and is fairly impossible without collaboration among researchers and across fields and institutions. So as we frame this project specifically as a Black digital humanities project, we're considering these questions of responsibility, which raise questions of both who's doing this work and how, but also for whom we recover Alice Dunbar-Nelson. And Denise will speak about this later. Even when recovery projects are responsible and successful, though, this work is still underrecognized and underfunded in our academic institutions. Even some colleges and universities that claim to care about public humanities fail to offer training to graduate students who want to pursue such projects, or to encourage faculty by adequately recognizing this work for tenure and promotion. And as a result, this work may be relegated to the status of an extra side project that scholars do only after they've accomplished other, more transparently rewarded work. This makes recovery projects difficult for scholars to pursue unless they hold exceptionally secure positions, which are increasingly rare. Among these systemic challenges, we want to acknowledge the exceptional material conditions of our own work, which we are grateful to have had supported in these early stages and which is necessary for its continuation. The first source of support is the Idle Family Fellows Program of the McNulty Institute at Villanova University. And we register the need for more programs like this one, which is specifically designed to support collaborative work that engages stakeholders outside the academic community and seeks to make a broader social impact. I come to Alice Dunbar-Nelson via one of the Steenth Street stories, which we can see here in the next slide, His Heart's Desire. This was part of a recent recovery project in which I didn't participate, but from which I have benefited greatly as a scholar and a teacher, allowing me to write about it and teach it in my classes on early Black feminist writers and on children's literature. But the recovery of the story is still incomplete and presents a stunning example of the complex issues involved in recovering this collection. This is a short story about a boy who wants a doll, and with the help of his kind teacher and his younger sister, receives one. His Heart's Desire is a fascinating piece for considering boyhood, gender norms, and childhood play, along with other overarching themes such as race, nationalism, education, and performance. And now Jean will share some of the details of recovering His Heart's Desire.
Thank you, Bridget. I got booted out early on, so I'm happy to be back with you all on Zoom. So in 2016, Legacy, a Journal of American Women Writers, which you can see pictured on this slide here, published a special issue on recovering Alice Dunbar-Nelson for the 21st century. It was edited by literary scholars Catherine Adams of Tulane University, Carolyn Gebhard of Tuskegee University, and Sandra Zagarel of Oberlin College. In addition to new scholarship on Dunbar-Nelson, the editors reprinted two poems that had originally appeared in early 20th century newspapers, and they recovered two stories from the Dunbar-Nelson papers at the University of Delaware Library. One of those stories was His Heart's Desire. I'm just gonna take a moment and read the first two paragraphs of the story so you can get a sense of what the story is like and her tone and her style. No one knew the secret desire which Andy Belton cherished in his inmost heart. He had never breathed it even to the sympathetic lady whom he had chosen as his love, who worked in a factory and had a beautiful hat with plumes on it and knew everything. Sometimes at night he lay awake and thought it over and wondered how it might come about that he might attain his heart's desire, but he always fell asleep before any plan could be worked out, and the morning found him as far from the goal as ever. It is possible that if Andy had told anyone his secret longing, it might have been granted. But Andy was a boy, and boys don't tell their hearts out, and he would have died rather than confess his weakness for the world to laugh at and jibe and jeer, for Andy wanted a doll. The story was originally titled, and you can see this in the next slide, it was originally titled Andy's Doll. You can see, oh, sorry, I gave you that. You can switch to the next one, Chris, sorry. I blew up the quote a little bit. At the top of this handwritten draft of the story, you can see originally, we think this is the first draft. You can see she called it Andy's Doll at the top. The Legacy Special Issue made His Heart's Desire available for teaching in college classrooms and for academic literary studies, adding to our understanding of Dunbar-Nelson's literary oeuvre. And since it was published in 2016, we have also learned more about the story and its publication history. Her papers show not only that Dunbar-Nelson intended His Heart's Desire to be part of a collection, the Annals of Steenth Street, as Bridget already explained, but also that Dunbar-Nelson sold the story to a periodical shortly after she wrote it. We can see the next slide will show this. Her itinerary for 1900 records that she sold the story, His Heart's Desire, for $5 to the Chicago Daily News. You can see it's the third one down from the top there. It was a typical price, but on the low end for a short story sold by an author to a mainstream newspaper at the time. The first 1 cent newspaper in Chicago, the Daily News served all classes and it boasted one of the highest circulations in Chicago. The next slide tells you a little more, gives you a little more of a sense of the newspaper. An 1893 ad in Printer's Ink observed that as many copies are sold per 1,000 people in the silk stocking wards as in the districts where the working men live. The Daily News acted as a feisty counterpart to the more elite Chicago Tribune. the Tribune did not surpass the Daily News in popularity until 1918. Some libraries today have access to digitized and searchable versions of the Chicago Daily News, but those subscriptions are really expensive. Old-fashioned microfilm reels of newspapers like the Daily News are cheaper and easier to find. Microfilm reels, as you probably know, they have to be loaded into a special machine and then scrolled through and projected onto a screen in a process that tends to make users more than a little queasy because you have all the print reels rolling by you. I hired a student to scroll through more than a year's worth of the Chicago Daily News microfilm looking for his heart's desire. And eventually they found it. Side note here, I just want to acknowledge that Villanova students contributed to this project at every stage, from reading microfilm to transcribing documents, comparing textual variants, interpreting stories, and doing public outreach. Thanks to all that microfilm reading, we now know that the first published version of His Heart's Desire appeared on June 21st, 1900, you can see in the next slide, you'll see this, in the Chicago Daily News. There it is. So this version likely reached way more readers in 1900 than the version that came out in the scholarly journal in 2016, which exists behind a paywall. Comparing the two versions of the story suggests to us that Dunbar-Nelson kept working on this story after she published it in the Chicago newspaper. She polished the language, she made it more concise and elegant, and she changed a few things, like some key features in the school pageant that Andy, the protagonist of the story, the pageant that Andy stars in. Dunbar-Nelson, who was also a dramatist, wrote several children's plays and pageants. And in the 1890s, school pageants were popular nationwide. They often projected a reassuring vision of national unity and shared values. And it's also true that there were many Black children that starred in the pageants. A lot of Black writers were interested in, Black women writers especially, were interested in writing them. In the story, His Heart's Desire, Andy is thrilled to be chosen as the leader of his school pageant, which is a great affair, it's called, designed to raise funds for the school to which, and it, the pageant gets more than half the story. So it gets a lot of attention in the story. While Andy waits to make his stage debut, he falls in love with an extravagant China doll that's for sale at a nearby booth. When the performance begins and he is called to the stage, draped in an American flag, he is supposed to take a leading role as a, quote, very young America in what is billed as the Grand Dewey finale. And in the next slide, we'll just take a moment to think about Dewey there. Andy is supposed to recite a poetic tribute to well-known war hero, U.S. Admiral George Dewey, whose decisive victory over the Spanish Pacific Fleet in 1898 at the Battle of Manila Bay marked the rise of the United States as an imperial power. Dewey was a dominant male role model in 1900. His defeat of Spain's decrepit warships led to the United States invasion of the Philippines. And when His Heart's Desire was published in 1900, US forces were still engaged in a brutal war with Filipinos who sought independence from colonial rule. Now the next slide, I wanna show you like what he was going to say, what Andy was supposed to say. A classmate of Andy's is cast as Admiral Dewey. He's posed in a heroic attitude at the feet of Miss Liberty. Andy's role, as we're told, is to cite a verse and lay a laurel wreath at the feet of Dewey. But when he's on stage, he sees a woman buying the doll he covets. He can't control his dismay. He steps out of character to protest and he ruins the pageant's finale, derailing his tribute to Admiral Dewey. The story juxtaposes lines of verse with descriptions of his panic. And I'll give you one example of this in the next slide. Admiral, this is Andy talking. Admiral, soldier, more than king. His eyes sought the booth where his flaxen-haired goddess sat. Mrs. Jackson, in charge of that booth, had that particular doll in her hand. The blue silk frock was too brilliant to be mistaken. Andy gulped a little and faltered. The young woman had turned from the booth with the doll in her hand. She was going away. His goddess was sold. He forgot everything. Dewey, his lines, the crowd, all. With one agonized cry, he threw the laurel wreath at the feet of the hero and sobbed aloud. My doll, she's tooked my doll. In Dunbar-Nelson's revised version of the story, Andy remains a flag-draped young America, but the Grand Dewey finale becomes the Grand Peace finale. Okay, so next slide, we can see this. his classmate now stands for world peace, not Admiral Dewey. Instead of singing a warrior's praises, Andy is supposed to step forward and recite, "Noble peace, to thee we sing, better far than sword or king. Let us raise our voices sweet, laying laurels at thy feet." It's a whiplash-inducing revision. Dunbar-Nelson goes from celebrating Dewey, a symbol of white male imperialism, the pageant does, to celebrating world peace. This is obviously a big change. It makes for a totally different performance and creates a different context for Andy's outburst about the doll. And it's just one example of the many fascinating moments in Dunbar-Nelson's writing that have gone unexplored. Her archive offers us clues to help us find all kinds of other stories in the newspaper as well. For instance, in the next slide, you can see that we found short story titles and dates scrawled on the back of an envelope that was filed along with one of the Steenth Street stories. That's one half of the envelope. You can see His Heart's Desire is the second one there. It didn't have a date on it, but some of them do. The next slide, you can see the other half of that envelope with some more titles of stories from Steenth Street. I'm including, I think Dunbar-Nelson was doing a little kind of doodling there, but The Passing of Briggs is another story that she published. And following clues like these, we found five more Steenth Street stories published in the Chicago Daily News. And we can just scroll through them as the next ones. I'll just read the titles of them as we go. A Little Mother in February of 1900. And then the next one is The Fate of a Coquette, which appeared in June 1900. And then the next one is Miss Tillman's Protege, which appeared in June 1900 as well. And then the next one is Abe Power's Downfall, which came out on Christmas Eve in 1900. And then there's another one, The Passing of Mr. Briggs, which came out in September of 1901. The publication of stories like these shows beyond a doubt that at the turn of the 20th century, Dunbar-Nelson's stories of childhood were available to many potential readers. Knowing that these 6 Steenth Street stories first appeared in a gritty, widely distributed metropolitan daily that people could get for a penny should make us think harder than ever about the best ways to make Dunbar-Nelson's work more accessible today. And as Bridget and Denise have reminded us from the beginning, have reminded me certainly from the beginning of our collaboration, if we want to recover Black authors, we must keep returning to the question, who benefits from their recovery? Okay, now Denise will talk about the evolution of our project.
Thank you so much, Jean. I have the little bit anxiety-producing responsibility of taking you through the evolution of the Steenth Street Project, which is going to give some shape and context to our existence and our identity as a Black digital humanities project. So bear with me. I hope that this will generate even more questions now that you've learned so much more about Alice Dunbar-Nelson, her body of work, and how fascinating and complex the content is. I truly hope that you will believe, which we are trying to create, a project that is worthy to carry her texts. The Steenth Street Project is a Black digital humanities project, which combines elements of feminist DH with a clear eye on producing digital pedagogy informed by all three, Black DH, feminist DH, and digital humanities pedagogy. That might seem like a mouthful, which I suspect, yes, yes, it is. But what we've been trying to do since Dr. Jean Lutz, who you just heard, called us into conversation just shy of a year ago, February, is to create an innovative Black DH project, which will recover, represent, reintroduce, reconsider, and remix texts by Alice Dunbar-Nelson, by focusing on her work as a Black woman author who wrote for and about, among others, particularly children in the early 20th century. The Steenth Street Project was created at this place of multiple intersections. So if DH, if digital humanities is more a methodology that seeks to study, research, teach, and invent using the digital both as a medium and as a method, and if DH therefore invites a deeper engagement with interdisciplinary methods, perspectives, and different ways of presenting information in the humanities, And if we in turn are able as scholars, students, researchers, and readers to ask more questions as a result of DH, not just about the text, the subjects, the readers, the learners, and the fields of study with which we are engaging, but sometimes more critically about computing, asking questions about computers, about the hardware and the software. If that is digital humanities, then the Steenth Street Project is just that, a Black DH project that is creating a digital format for Alice Dunbar-Nelson's Steenth Street story collection, which will include not just the ability to compare and contrast different editions, different iterations, as you already heard both Bridget and Jean discussing, include a critical edition of the collection of the Annals of Steenth Street, a K through 12 curriculum, and teacher training modules produced in partnership with the Philadelphia School District. We will also have, which we already have, resource lists for historic African-American children's books. Did you even know that this is an established genre of children's literature, which African-American authors have been creating and contributing to at least since the turn of the 19th century? Digital exhibits, community presentations, essays, and much more. All of what I just described comprises what the Steenth Street Project has been working to create. And if the Black digital humanities is an approach to community, methodology, praxis, and theory in the digital humanities that centers Black thought and cultural production, or more poetically in the words of Jessica Marie Johnson and Mark Anthony Neal, if Black DH roots itself in the challenge of living in the wake of Black people rendered inhuman, non-existent, and disposable by the slave ship, the plantation, the colonial state, the prison, the border, and as Marissa Parham sagely reminds, Black people deserve frivolity of future, the Steenth Street Project is Black DH. I want to pause and put extra emphasis on the idea of the future in Black DH work. In order for a future to exist, there must needs be a present. As Bridget outlined earlier, the Steenth Street Project is at its core recovery work, which relies both on reintroduction and representation in order to be successful. So much of Black DH is concerned and must be concerned with both elements, recovery and representation simultaneously, because of the combined and powerfully effacing effects of racism and sexism, both then as now. Said another way, the erasure evident in humanities archives and in the canons which they produce, which erase Black people, but especially Black women, in turn produces these absences in lists, in syllabi, in curriculum, in popular discourse, and therefore understanding and knowledge. Said another way, there's a reason many people haven't heard of Alice Dunbar-Nelson and many other Black women authors. These absences can be replicated if missing authors, topics, texts, and subjects are assumed to be a correct reflection of history. Though we know this is not true, it is hard to convince someone that an author was a prolific and important contributor to multiple genres like Alice Dunbar-Nelson if they cannot readily Google it. The Steenth Street Project is speaking into these spaces, into these gaps and these silences, insisting that Dunbar-Nelson's work will be read by generations of African-American children as part of their school education curriculum, that Dunbar-Nelson's work will be discovered by people who take the time to Google. We are determined that children and their families will not only know who Dunbar-Nelson was, but enjoy her work, learning from her texts to think about topics ranging from class to the urban built environment, to gender, to poverty and personal integrity in interesting and culturally relevant ways. The Steenth Street Project again meets the standards of Black DH by respectfully approaching Dunbar-Nelson and the Steenth Street stories, determined to bring her work as a Black woman poet, writer, educator, critic, and activist back into circulation for all readers, but primarily to her chosen audience of children through our work with readers, teachers, and educators as a form of justice. we are working to make sure that Dunbar-Nelson's Annals of Steenth Street will be on future syllabi, that teachers are taught how to teach her texts, and that her work is readily available in multiple formats to the widest possible audiences in order to bring her work into a new renaissance, a Black digital renaissance. The Philly School District does not just serve a majority of African-American children student body, but is a district that is under a state mandate to teach African-American history and topics. Through our work with Philly School District educators, we are therefore ensuring that these teachers and educators will have the information and resources they need to teach Dunbar-Nelson and other Black women writers with skill and confidence. We will continue to seek out ways to interface with the Black community in different forums and formats, not unlike this format here tonight with the Robeson House, to continue to dialogue about Dunbar-Nelson. We are committed to making her texts as accessible to as wide a community of readers as possible, with a focus on Black communities. This is part of why we chose a digital format and medium for our work in conjunction with libraries, organizations, and other schools. Next slide, please. In this ongoing effort, next again, we're trying to see, that's Dunbar-Nelson again, there we go. In this effort, thank you, we have partnered with Shakita Smith and Ismael Jimenez at the School District of Philadelphia as we create teacher training modules for Philly School District teachers. Next slide, please. Shakita is the social studies curriculum for the School District of Philadelphia. She helps open worlds and doors for more than 200,000 students every year. A former classroom educator for over a decade, Ms. Smith's dedication to bringing the very best of Philly students is matched by the passion of Ismael Jimenez. Next. Mr. Jimenez is a dedicated educator who for the last 13 years has worked with students in Philadelphia. The philosophical orientation that guides Jimenez's teaching and activism is rooted in the theoretical educational framework developed by Paulo Freire, which emphasizes the interconnected nature of education with participating in the transformation of the world. Next. If DH feminism aims to emphasize and increase the role of women and feminists in technology and digital humanities, as well as approach technological questions with a feminist lens, then again, the Steenth Street Project is an expression of feminist DH. Not only is our entire core team female, we approach all our work with Dunbar-Nelson's text using a critical feminist lens, a clear analysis of the ways that gender shows up in her text, in the reception of her work, and the incorporation of her work as an author, poet, educator, and activist. So since I've established all of that, you might be wondering, how did we all come together? It's a good question. Toward the last few weeks of February last, Dr. Jean Lutz, whom we've already had the pleasure to meet, emailed Dr. Bridget Fielder and me with an intriguing proposition. Jean was, quote, looking for a partner or partners to help produce a critical edition of Dunbar-Nelson's never published together Steenth Street stories, and was considering applying to be one of the SSAWW, you've heard mentioned already tonight as well, the Society for the Study of American Women Writers, Digital Recovery Cubs Cultivation Projects. Jean had completed a fair amount of work toward the edition with some help from a student research team at Villanova. Though originally imagining this as a traditional print edition, Jean proposed that ultimately the stories she suspected would be far more accessible if they were made available in a good critical edition online, because that way people would not have to pay for access to the material. Jean was already familiar with Bridget's wonderful essay On His Heart's Desire by Dunbar-Nelson and my work with the Colored Conventions Project and SSAWW. She was clear that she did not want to proceed further without involving BIPOC scholars in a significant way, including undergraduates at Villanova who had begun textual editing and analysis under her supervision. Bridget and I enthusiastically said yes. We started meeting and exploring not just our love for Dunbar-Nelson, but what we would like the world to know about her and her work. As you might have already figured out, we have never met in person. We all felt then as now that Dunbar-Nelson was understudied. Considering the quality, range, and depth of her text, her poetry, her journalism, her essays, sermons, short stories, and the volume of work she produced, it is simply outrageous that Dunbar-Nelson is not a household name. Each of us came to Dunbar-Nelson from different places, as you've already heard, but were routed through the work of scholars who organized the SSAWW for very similar reasons. To refocus our interest, our time, and our scholarship on women writers, and particularly Black women writers. We've chosen to pursue this deeper work of recovery and the creation of a Black DH project to press against the erasures, the silences, the resistances that have existed and continue to exist against the presence and the work of Black women writers. Cashay Garland, who you heard speak earlier, offered an honest answer at the beginning of the Steenth Street Project when she was asked about Dunbar-Nelson. And she literally said, before she started working on this project, I knew nothing about her. Jean and Bridget have told you much more about Dunbar-Nelson. And later on this evening, Cashay will provide you with even more opportunities to read her work and stay connected with our project and our goals. Now I'm going to introduce you to our entire team. Next slide, please. That's Cashay. Next slide. That's Jean. Next slide. It's Bridget. Next slide. That's me. Next slide. All right. So before we move on to the call of action, the rest of the team, Gia Beaton, Daniel Burns, Maddie Davids, John Flynn, Amanda Gerstenfield, Michaela Grassi, Kaylee Manya, Lucinda Mileto, and Jackie Solomon are all students at Villanova who have worked diligently on the text analysis, which I mentioned earlier, and research. Without their careful and dedicated work, our project would not be able to function. The hours of meeting, thinking, planning, networking, and dreaming that were required to bring the Steenth Street Project into existence requires one element more so than any other: collaboration. Though DH by nature requires deep collaboration between the multiple partners and parties in order to create effective projects, the Steenth Street Project is even more so because of its origins, structure, and intentions. Conceived and executed during the current pandemic, completely over Zoom, the telephone, Google Docs, and through the dedication each of us has to learn, to listen deeply, to think carefully, and work together independently and synchronously, to the effect that we were able to continue to successfully implement what we have purposed to do, will be a testament to the power and importance of collaboration. We are deeply grateful to each member of the Steenth Street team for their presence, commitments, and work, and hope you, our listeners, will consider joining us in this ongoing work. I'm gonna ask Cashay to do the call to action. So Chris, if you don't mind going back to that slide, thank you so much.
All right, thank you, Denise. So I'm gonna post a couple links in the chat, so just be aware of what's going on. The first one is gonna be a Google Docs link that's gonna have a recommended reading list. Just give me 1 second. All right, so there's one thing to take away from this presentation is definitely to read more. I mean, for myself, since I wasn't familiar really much with Alice Dunbar-Nelson prior to the project, and I have read a couple of her stories for the project, and I have read some biographies about her, but I actually decided to get my first book about her, the first biography. I'm pretty sure that's actually well written out, that just got released not too long ago. I'm blanking on the author, but currently reading that now so I can get more information, take advantage of what is already out here, and allow yourself to question what is being left out and what else is out there for you. And ask your libraries to order books that they don't have them. Please do. I mean, the more you know, the more you have. And then my second link I'm going to post right now. So this is about Black Lives Matters at school. It's about putting more Black history and authors into school curriculums. So you go to the Black Lives Matter at School website, where you'll find resources curated by Chris Rogers, a PhD candidate in the Reading, Writing, Literacy program at the University of Pennsylvania. So that link is also provided for you. And then finally, I'm providing a Google form where you can fill out if you want to leave your your name, your email address, or any questions and comments that you may have that we may not be able to answer tonight. And back to you, Denise.
Thanks so much, Cache. All right, and this will feel very familiar to the way Chris started us for tonight's meeting. So I'm gonna ask everyone to take a deep breath. Hold your breath for a couple of moments and then release it slowly. Take another deep breath. Hold your breath and release it slowly. As Chris recognized, there's a lot that's going on in our world that is difficult to imagine and difficult to contemplate. It is even more important, I think, we think, for us to remain as grounded as possible. So I'm going to ask you, if you're comfortable to do so, to just close your eyes, feel where you are. You're sitting down on a chair, maybe at a desk, sitting down maybe in a chair at your kitchen table, or if you're sitting down in a comfortable chair in your living room or on your sofa or maybe in your bed, wherever you are, just kind of feel the space around you, to sit in that space and to relax just a bit. We're at the last two or three moments before we close this out. And to thank you again for coming and for staying with us for the duration. And for those of you who will watch this online after the fact, I'm also inviting you to do the same thing. We're all connected in this virtual medium. I want to deliberately invite you into the last piece that I was discussing before Cache very graciously provided us with the call to action. And that is, we want to invite you into the spirit of the Steenth Street Project by focusing on the act and the intention of collaboration. I would like to take this time, as we are, I hope, more relaxed and a bit more grounded, to remind you who joined with us tonight that this project only exists because we have chosen deliberately to work together. It is a better, more promising initiative because we have found and we have continued to make the time to listen carefully to each other. What we're asking you to do, particularly in this time that feels so fractious and precarious, is to think of an area in your life or in your work, in your recreation, that could benefit from more collaboration. How can you, as an individual, as a member of a team, of a group, of a community, of a committee, more deliberately incorporate the principle, the praxis, the exercise, the practice of collaboration in your work? We invite you, particularly during this time, to do just that. And on this note of an invitation into collaboration, I close our presentation. Thank you so very much for joining us. Chris?
Oh my gosh, that was amazing. I don't want to call anybody on the spot, but if you could, you know, turn on your videos for a second, I would love, because I'm thinking about also the people who have come here tonight. I see a lot of people who have, you know, in some ways made, you know, specific and deliberate time within their lives to recover the legacies of Black women writers, of Black women artists, and kind of continue that work as well. So I just want to, you know, for you all to be able to share that love with the folks who are here in the room. We will have just a little bit of time for just a short Q&A. We had some things come through in the chat as we were going through, but, you know, such a wonderful presentation. It feels, as you said, you know, looking through microfilm of a thing. So much of this presentation is only just the tip of an iceberg. And just to even think about that, there's a 3-volume set of Alice Dunbar-Nelson's work that is out there. There's still much for us to sort of like look and live with as we move forward. So there they go. I see them. And I was talking, you know, great story is Miss Bernadine, if she's still on the call. She posted on my Facebook earlier, was like, I got my one, you know? And I was like, I gotta find it. We gotta find it. Make sure they have space in Philadelphia. So I did see some things come in into the chat earlier, but also wanna hold space for, you know, if anybody else has any questions to continue to put those into the chat, or, you know, there's a small enough amount of folks that if you would like to speak them, you can. And I'll offer that opportunity to Dara. Dara, would you like to like ask your question yourself? Or would you like me to read it? All right. Well, I'll say I'll begin by reading. And if you want to jump in and add more to it, you can. And Dara asked, why was it mentioned earlier that it is not common knowledge when referring to Alice Dunbar-Nelson that she was a fair-skinned woman? Anybody have something to add or add to that picture, add to that story?
Yeah, well, I mean, this is something that, you know, does appear in Alice Dunbar-Nelson's writing for folks who have read some of her work. Not only her own presentation as a light-skinned Black woman, but some of the kind of racial ambiguities of her characters has been a topic of a lot of conversation about her work. She's known for writing, say, Creole characters whose race is kind of ambiguous in the stories and whose scholars have really kind of debated about in different ways in thinking about how we're supposed to understand them being racialized, for one. And so there's a lot of ways that race becomes not only something that's visible in Alice Dunbar-Nelson's writing, but something that you know, we have to think of in different ways, because in other stories, like some of the Steenth Street stories, she just doesn't give us a whole lot of information about the racialization of her characters, even while in others she does. And so how race and especially mixed race works is, you know, one kind of theme that runs through a good portion of her writing.
Thank you. Thank you for that. We probably have a couple, you know, more minutes. If anyone would like to sort of like speak or even just comment, you know, it doesn't always have to be a question. It could just be a note of gratitude. We certainly have space for that. I certainly have a question, but I'm gonna do my little, you know, 5 second teacher wait time. And then if not, I'll come back to my question. And the question that I have is, you all, oh, Cassandra.
Yes, I'd like to commend everyone on their scholarship, their persistence, their imagination. Not only are you researching, you're creating a unique vision and application of how to bring something into the 21st century. So, kudos, thank you, and also to present it out to the world. Now, that takes chutzpah, but it also takes vision to say that there's a space in the world for this to be accepted. So thank you.
Yes, I love how you modeled that, Ms. Cassandra, as well. Notes of gratitude are always important, and it kind of gets into what connects you to the question, because I heard from many of you all of you know, what sustains you within this project. And I could just only imagine, as you know, you said, like, this project has its origins in the midst of, you know, this pandemic, and finding ways to sort of like stay connected and do this research. And I can only think about the many different challenges that go along with that, whether it's, you know, the relational work. So I would love to hear more about like how you all have met and overcome the challenges of sustaining this community in the midst of the pandemic. Please teach me, because I feel like I need to learn too.
I would love to hear Cache talk about this, like about what it's been like for you. You're the future, and you're the youngest member of our team that's here present today. Like, what would you say about that?
I mean, it's hard being so like disconnected and meeting on Zoom and stuff like that. It's like you have to find the right meeting times. People live in different time zones and things like that. And also just trying to line up, especially like me being a student and going on Zoom, being on Zoom for like the past 2 years and stuff like that, you're like, oh God, another Zoom meeting and stuff. But when it's something that you're passionate about and it's something that we're like, we can be on meetings for like 2 hours and we don't even notice it's 2 hours. Like if the conversation's flowing, if it's going great, if we're doing planning and stuff like that, like we'll look up, Dr. Lucy be like, oh my God, it's been like 2 hours, we gotta go. Like it'll just keep going and stuff like that. So it doesn't feel like exhausting, but knowing that at the end of the Zoom meeting, like there's an end goal and we're getting further, makes it all the better to like wake up at maybe 9 o'clock in the morning for like us on Eastern time, or 8 o'clock in the morning to do a Zoom meeting and stuff. But we also just do well with just communication, emailing, setting up schedules, group me, any type of way to just always link us together. And I feel like that's the way to just keep the project moving. Like we never felt like, or at least I never felt like I was like disconnected in any type of way, even despite us all not being in the same place. And luckily for me, like I go to Villanova, Dr. Luce is my professor, like she's on campus and stuff. So that keeps me even more connected. But I think everyone's so proactive in what we have to do. And we'll schedule as many meetings as possible just to get the work done no matter what, even though we're all in different places, all in different time zones. Even if one person can't make it, someone else is always there. So it's just making sure you have a very like engaging team and a team that's passionate and very focused. That's what keeps you going in this type of environment, because it is definitely hard sitting on Zoom for hours on end and not seeing each other's faces, not knowing how to interact. I mean, we have like technical issues, someone's getting kicked out of the Zoom, someone can't message what's going on and things like that. But you just got to make it work with whatever you have, and that's the best way to do it.
I mean, I'd say that the working in collaboration actually in many ways ends up, while it's logistically difficult, it ends up being easier in a lot of ways than doing work by yourself. During the pandemic, especially, I've been really interested in work that takes one out of the little caves that we build when we pretend that's like scholarly work is just like a single person reading books by dead people and writing about them for no one to read. And that's not really fulfilling, but it is fulfilling to talk to other people. And the immense amount of work to be done in early African American writing is kind of overwhelming. But not when you think about the ways that the kind of community around that work gets built. And people are really generous. They share stuff. When I was scrolling in an archive, looking at sad microfilm, I wrote to somebody who I thought would have the information I needed, and they gave it to me happily. This is the kind of project that we wouldn't be able to do any of us by ourselves. Or if we attempted it, it would take much, much, much longer. But the work that we can do together is really more than the sum of its parts. And so, our collaboration with school teachers in Philadelphia and, telling us, trying to orient this work towards the curricular needs of actual children, is something that we needed to partner with somebody else for, recognizing that you can't do everything yourself. And finding the people who can do the things that you can't do, makes the work possible in ways that it really just wouldn't be otherwise.
Yeah, absolutely. I want to build on that. I think that the limitations
and the constraints that have been imposed by the pandemic are clear and present. But there are also ways that the pandemic, because we've had to figure out how to operate in this changed environment, has created opportunities. And so we know automatically that we're going to meet on Zoom because, well, you have to meet on Zoom. But that meant also that even though we're in two different time zones, we're all in different states, we immediately knew how to actually coordinate this and work that out. I think it might have been a little harder. I think there may have been more resistance. What do you mean meet on Skype or Zoom? Well, no one even uses Skype anymore, so I don't know why I said that. But what do you mean meet on Zoom? For what? Like, no, this is not going to work. But that never even crossed anyone's mind. We already knew everything was already online. Everything was already virtual. So, okay, then how can we exploit that? How can we lean into that? And as it's turned out, the conversations have been extraordinarily rich and generative. Everybody comes, as Cache said, that the time will be clicking away. And for the members of the team who have kids or pets, you know, they're demanding attention as they should. And or other things come up. Everyone is extraordinarily gracious and responsive. We kind of spend some time checking in before we start the working meetings. If someone can't attend, everyone is really gracious and generous. And so it ends up, it's a lot of work. I mean, we've done a lot of work and we've produced a lot, but it ends up being, gosh, it's a supportive and generative environment that we, I think, have conscientiously created, and one that is very dependent on this virtual space, because it would have been much more difficult otherwise. Actually, I think it would have been almost impossible. Yeah, literally, we would not have been able to have done this. Maybe even 5 years ago. I don't even know if, you know, 10 years for sure. But I'd say even 5 years ago, because again, the facility that we have with these virtual meetings and working virtually and communicating virtually and using Google Docs and just getting all of it done, we've all been trained to do that now. Coming out of a Black DH project, the Color Conventions project, anyone who's been working with the DH project has a greater facility with all of these things, but that has become exponentially greater throughout the pandemic because everyone had to. So I think there's a way that this Black DH project probably wouldn't really exist in this way if it was just like Bridget said in the chat at another time in the not so distant past. But we've made it work very well.
So as we come to a close here this evening, Tara Green, you know, we mentioned this new biography of Alice Dunbar-Nelson. Tara Green, I worked on and brought into the world. And she tweeted earlier today a quote from Alice Dunbar-Nelson. It says, "Wars are made by old men, fought by young men, and paid for by women and children." And I thought that to be such a, you know, I appreciated her lifting up that timely, you know, very timely quote from Alice. And I think as we close today, what I would love to hear from you all is, like, if you were to meet, you know, Alice Dunbar-Nelson after all of you read and experienced, like, what would you say, you know, as we close out tonight? You know, I just want to hear from everybody, you know, what would you say to Alice Dunbar-Nelson? What would you ask her, you know, as we close out tonight?
Well, I would thank her. I would just say thank you. I would thank her. I would also really want to thank her niece, Pauline Hawk, for saving her, because that's the reason we have her archive. So I'm very grateful for both of those women in different ways. And what I would ask her, oh my God, I want to ask her, like, what were you doing with this story and which was the right ending? And like, what did you want to, I can't, but that's what I would ask her. You know, I'd love to know. Like, what were you thinking when you changed that? When you went from celebrating a warmonger to celebrating world peace? Like, so that's what I'd ask.
Well, what I've said, oh, go ahead.
Now, it's real responsible. Not surprised that Jean would say that. I'd want to know the dish. What was going on in the Harlem Renaissance? Who was with who? How? Who? Why did you write this poem? Were you really, you know, subtweeting, to use our contemporary language, this person over here or that person? Can I get some clarification here? Because inquiring minds want to know, you know. I mean, we see all this incredible right. literary production, but what was really going on? No, just you know, that would be my question.
And like just what it's like to see that arc of Black literary production, right? Because like Alice Dunbar-Nelson is not the first Black woman to write a billion things. You know, there are predecessors, but she is already there in, you know, the turn of the century producing stuff that is, you know, that comes already out of a, like, you know, a century, more than century long Black literary tradition. And then she takes that through into the whole Harlem Renaissance. And in the 1930s, she's still got to ask people like, can we like give Black children some Black books to read? And so just like, what is, you know, like what is going on with those decades of work, you know, and how do you see that as somebody who, you know, isn't making that argument in a way that is uninformed about the literary past, because she was already producing that literary past herself. Because it's so odd for us here in our moment where people think that Black people like learned to write in the Harlem Renaissance and just started producing, you know, poetry and fiction and whatnot in a relatively late moment. But she's part of that shift. And she's editing, she's doing all kinds of, you know, it's, you know, a really great example of Black women just doing everything to make this work happen. And she is, you know, in it from like Paul Lawrence Dunbar and through the, you know, from the Harlem Renaissance writers, watching this happen. And I feel like that's like just really an amazing period of Black literature to think about, and often gets erased in our imaginings of like when Black literature is.
I think for me, I would ask her about how she felt about her place as a like a light-skinned woman and stuff like that. That was actually discussed in the Tara Green biography, was that a lot of times Dunbar-Nelson would associate with just with light-skinned women, not really dark-skinned women and stuff like that. And she would often separate herself sometimes from the Black race in a way, like some of her letters to Paul, she would like call a lot of Black people like the N-word in like a harsh way. And I just thought that was just like really interesting. Like she'll make fun of them and stuff like that. So I'd kind of be interested to see like where she saw herself as a Black woman, because we praise her so much for being, you know, for owning her Blackness and things like that. But it's just so interesting to see how she views herself and handled herself during that time. And I think like the colorism part of it, because I think we can't ignore that. When it comes to her also, is that she had a lot of privileges. She was able to blend in. She looked white sometimes, like she had that whitewashedness part of her. So I think that part is interesting. And also the tea about her and Paul. I mean, I just want to know what got her, like she was so adamant on not being with him, like being married to him and moving down there with him and stuff like that. And what made her really change her mind? The letters only say so much, but it'd be interesting to see and hear her say it. And then what made her go into her relationship with women right after that?
Yeah, I appreciate that too. And I think, you know, also what I appreciate about this work is recovering legacies of Black queer women at the turn of the, you know, into the early 1900s. Such an important, you know, piece of work that there's a lot to be gained from that work as well. So I just want to thank you all, right, for bringing this to us, bringing this to the Paul Robeson House Museum. We see you all as one in the community of folks who are around us. I know there's also this connection with Wilmington, Delaware, right? In terms of how we recover and recuperate, you know, expansive Black legacies in the arts and contributions to just, you know, in shaping our world. So I just wanted, you know, thank you, the Paul Robeson House and Museum, for making space tonight with us for this event. I hope you know, are not strangers. We look forward to hosting you at the house one day. We are back open for digital appointments. So that goes for y'all and anybody else who's still watching right now. And We look forward to continued collaboration. And thank you. Excited to see this project succeed on its own terms. And yeah, I'm with you, Ms. Denise. We need more tea. We need more tea about these lives at the turn of the 20th century. Let's keep it going. And I'll see you all later. Robeson House PHL. And the website to find out more about this project is? Or where can they go again?
Cache, you have the, do you have a link to share for them, right? Did you already share
it? The Google form, right?
Mm-hmm. Is it okay?
Yeah, put that in the chat. Do you want me to put it again?
Is it okay if we put that out on our socials and all that?
Mm-hmm. It's open. Perfect.
So great. Thank you all for coming tonight. Everybody have a good night. Get rest, drink some water, and see you next time.